Cindy and I want to welcome you as we continue our X Factor series. We're going to actually start the message off in Z Pizza. We're being hosted by our longtime New Hope members, Cesar and Karen Lorenas, and we are so excited to be here because this is where God wants to join us. In fact, the name of the message today is Work With Me. And I want you to picture where you work. Now, that may be a wonderful place or maybe something you're just enduring. Wherever it is you're working, that's actually where you spend most of your time. Yeah. You don't spend most of your time where you're sitting right now in church. You spend most of your time maybe in a place like this. And in fact, the pizza place is open, so you may see customers, may even smell some pizza coming Hopefully. Through. But the whole goal is that we would understand God is not limited to an hour and a half on a weekend service. No, he actually wants to join you where you work. Paul puts it this way in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 7. He says, serve wholeheartedly. Serve the Lord, not man. In other words, we're supposed to be working for him first. And that's really, really good because sometimes work is hard.
Well, yeah, and it doesn't necessarily change our work, but it changes our perspective on work. And I know for people like me, I work part-time outside of the house, but most of my time is home. And yeah. I work dealing with kids and just tasks. And when I'm just in it for, you know, working for the man, the little man.
And they're kind of demanding
the little
sometimes.
Men that are, yeah, then it's easy to get, you know, frustrated and just, you know, feel overwhelmed. But when I truly work as unto the Lord, I'm able to serve and it changes my perspective. The work is the same, the tasks are the same, but my perspective changes and I actually begin to enjoy a little bit more what I'm doing.
Which is good because they don't give you much of a paycheck, do you?
I haven't had a raise in like 15 years, so we gotta talk about that.
And so when we're serving wholeheartedly to the Lord, we're not defined by our paycheck or the numbers on it. We're not defined by how our boss is treating us. In fact, speaking of bosses, maybe you have a great boss, but I think Daniel takes the cake and gets the award for the worst boss ever. Yeah. Because as we talked about a couple weeks ago, King Nebuchadnezzar basically told Daniel, unless you tell me my dream and interpret it, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill your friends. I'm going to kill all of your fellow employees. And so rather than panicking, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, what did they do? They prayed. They prayed for their king. They prayed for their pagan employees, and because of that, they invited God into their work.
Yeah.
And as a result, God showed them the dream, gave them the interpretation, and then, Cindy, why don't you share with us what happened to King Nebuchadnezzar's heart as a result?
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. We're going to read out of the Life Connect Bible, Daniel 2, verse 46 to 48. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel and paid him honor and ordered that an offering and incense be presented to him. The king said to Daniel, surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings, a revealer of mysteries, for you were able to reveal this mystery. Then the king placed Daniel in a high position and lavished many gifts on him. He made him ruler over the entire province of Babylon and placed him in charge of all of its wise men. Wow.
So not only did Daniel and his friends not die, he got a promotion.
Yeah.
How many of you guys are wanting a promotion? Yeah. Yeah. Wouldn't that be great? Well, start by praying for the people that you're working with. And here's why it's so important that we work with God at work. Work becomes this intersection for our faith and our fellow employee or employers. It becomes this crucible where our faith is truly tested. And a lot of times people that you're working with are never going to come and hear a sermon on a weekend service. Mm-hmm. They're hearing about Jesus through how you're living your life through the really hard times. In fact, you can actually fill in your first blank that work is where the world sees the story in the storm. This is where God shows who he is through how you're walking your faith out in a really, really difficult time.
Yeah.
You know, it's the collision or the intersection between your occupation and your vocation. The difference is your occupation is what you get a paycheck for. Your vocation is what you were designed to do. For instance, the Apostle Paul, his occupation was tent making, but his vocation was church planting, ministering, to share the gospel with the Gentiles. Where did that wind him up? Well, in Acts, we see he wound up in the middle of the storm. And just like Daniel and his friends, he didn't panic. He prayed, and in this passage, you actually see where God turns the heart of everybody on the ship in the middle of the storm. They're all watching this one man and his faith, and it all turns their eyes towards him. Why don't you share that with
us? That's right. If you want to read along with me in your notes or on the screen, it's Acts 27, verses 33 to 36. Ready? Go.
Just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat.
For the last 14 days, he said, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food.
You haven't eaten anything.
Now I urge you to take some food.
You need it to survive.
Not one of you will lose a single hair from your head.
After he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all. Then he broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged and ate some food themselves.
That's so good, because God has us living out our faith in the middle of the storm with lots of onlookers. You're not just working where you're working by accident. It's actually on purpose. It's by providence that God put you there so that you could show your faith in the middle of the hard things going on. And in fact, you get to eat. They shared bread. They gave thanks to God. These people that didn't even love God before. And God uses those common things, the things that we spend every day using in our workplaces, to bring him to everybody.
Yeah.
Everybody that we're working with. Everybody that's in our lives. Where we're spending most of our time. In fact, that's kind of why we're here in Z Pizza today, because we're going to break some bread or some crust together.
We're definitely going to eat.
And we're going to hear Caesar's story and Karen's story and how God has used their restaurant here, this pizza place, and their story to begin to show who he is to the world around them. Let's go.
Looking forward to it.
This is where our toppings are.
That's all the goodness right there.
We have our dough over here.
Okay.
And let it sit for a while.
Okay.
Yeah. And as you can see, this is the all natural pepperoni.
All natural. Now that's one of the things about Z Pizza, right? Is that all the ingredients are all natural. Nothing's processed, right?
And everything is fresh. Hopefully that if we have someone locally, we try to get what's local.
Yeah. Oh, that's wonderful. Now, what got you interested in pizza in the first place?
Actually, I really want to own a burger joint.
So on the way to a burger, you ended up at pizza. I love how God works.
Today, we're going to make what we call the Provence, the vegetarian pizza. And
my wife will be happy about that.
So all we need to do is just take this, and then you just have to roll it.
And that's flour?
Yeah. This is a combine of flour and cornmeal.
Okay.
And then from here, you just turn on this. What you do is just stretch it up. And let me see this toss.
Oh yeah, here we go. And that's when you know you're making real pizza.
Yeah. Basically, you put it in the screen.
Okay.
And make sure it covers all the screen. You need to put some olive oil. It's 100% pure olive oil. Put the edges, so the edges will be all crispy. Then you put
the garlic sauce, the crushed garlic.
You try to cover everything on this when you're putting the sauce.
Okay.
Then you get the tomato sauce.
The organic tomato sauce.
I think you just the organic is like you're just eating it right from the
vine,
the fruits. Yeah. Then we have to put one of this, one scoop.
Fresh mozzarella.
Yeah. So we need tomatoes, artichokes, and capers.
Ooh.
So
what's great about this is this is an authentically guilt-free pizza here, right?
Right.
You can eat this and you don't have to feel bad about it.
That's right.
Nothing greasy, nothing's gonna weigh you down. It's basically like eating a salad. So I can eat this and tell Cindy, I had a salad for lunch. This is awesome. This is the best of both worlds right here.
Yeah. Okay, you want to try it?
Okay. All right, now we're in business. Now I just begin to kind of stretch it out, right?
Stretch it out, you know.
Should I toss it? He's nervous, you're stepping back.
You can try.
Okay, here we go. One, two.
Woo! All right. I feel like an official pizzeria. This is so awesome. Oh my gosh. Okay, so I just stretch it out till it reaches the sides, right? And then
so we don't cheat the customer.
Exactly, know? Yes.
Plus that's... you have to be honest on your business, you know.
Yeah, so honesty and integrity works itself out even to the how you're stretching the crust. That's really good.
Yeah.
And then this goes around the sides.
On the edge.
To make it extra crispy. All right, and then the garlic.
Yeah. Have you seen the Karate Kids? You
know? Wax on, wax off?
Yeah.
Is this a wax on, wax off moment? Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. Okay.
Yeah.
Wax on. Oh, this is, you're my Miyagi. This is awesome, Cesar. See, I knew there was a method to this when I saw you doing it. And now I'm right there with you. The Karate Kid thing, it clicked for me. Wax on, wax off. So what do you look for? You know, you talked about the honesty and just even the crust. What do you look for when you're hiring an employee? What's some essential ingredients, if you will, for an employee?
First is they have to be teachable.
Okay,
teachable. You know, and they have to put their heart in making the pizza because it's going to show on your pizza.
Wow. Wow, that's really good. So when you are just going through the motions, or it's just a job. It shows itself in the quality, right?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Afterwards. If I just slide it in there?
Yeah, right there.
I'll put it on here. Okay. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. That's going to be good. Cesar and Karen, it's such a joy to be here, talk story with you guys. Yeah, and, you guys have been running this business for a number of years, and there's a lot of pressure. What are some of the things that God has taught you over the years as you've been running this amazing pizza establishment in your faith, and how that kind of intersects with your fellow employees and the pressures of just running a business?
You know, what I tell the employees is that your ministry is how you make the pizza.
Mm.
Because, you know, when you make the pizza really well, people will see that and they will say, wow, this is a nice pizza. Versus if you don't put your heart in it, you know, they can see that too.
Mm-hmm.
So that's gotta be your prime ministry, you know, in making the pizza.
Doing the best job you can, whatever
being
task.
The best of what you...
Yeah. Whether it's cleaning the tables.
But, sure.
Yeah.
Sure. What are some things you could share with maybe some who are watching this right now, and they're either an employee or an employer, and they're trying to figure out how to work their faith out in this very secular setting. This is not a church, and yet what I've found is that God will show himself through how hard we're working.
Yeah.
Maybe what are some things that you've learned that have helped you over the years in doing that?
Well, you got to understand, this business, it's not your own.
Mm.
This is God's own, you know. When you set your mind to that, that means that you do everything for God, not for yourself.
Yeah.
You know, all the things you do, it's gotta be the best.
It means so much to Cindy and I that you would take the time to talk story with us here today, because your life has recently been tossed because of some real health challenges. You guys wanna tell us about that?
It was October 31st, and he had an endocarditis, which is an infection on your heart valve. So he had a staph infection on his heart valve, which caused multiple strokes. It affected his kidneys. His kidneys shut down. He had gone into septic shock. He ended up on the on a ventilator for 2 weeks. I tell you, it was a time when you feel so helpless. You can only cry out to the Lord. He's the only one who can provide. The doctors had given up hope. At the end of the 2 weeks, they were already counseling us to remove the life support. I refused to receive that.
Mm.
And they kept telling me, you don't understand how serious this is or what this is going to do to him. But I said, my trust is in the Lord. And I said, it is not his time.
Yeah.
It is not his time.
Wow.
You know, God was so faithful. We had so many people praying for him. We had family and friends. We had acquaintances, we had people we didn't even know that were praying for him around the world.
Yeah.
Keola came to the hospital. He was one of the first ones from Europe to come in. And he just got on his knees before the Lord to intercede for him.
Wow.
He's crying out to God. And, you know, he was in a medically induced coma. And when we would, when people would come and pray for him, you could see tears coming down. There's no way he could have heard the prayers.
Wow.
And so you know that his spirit was alive
was
and well.
Was receiving even while his mind wasn't.
Yes.
Wow.
His,
so powerful.
Yeah. They did an angiogram before the test. Before the surgery, they had to do the angiogram, and they told me that the dive and the angiogram would ruin his kidneys forever, that that would be it.
Oh, wow.
That if he survived, he would be on dialysis for the rest of his life. And I refused to receive that, and I said, no, Lord, I don't think that that's what you would have for him.
Yeah.
And praise God, November 30th was his last day for dialysis. He made it through 30 days in the ICU and then another 2 weeks in the hospital. He was able to go to Aloha Nursing and Rehab and was there for 2 months.
So this is truly miraculous that you're here today.
Yeah.
Throwing pizza, not just here.
Throwing pizza, pizzas. Not on dialysis, yeah. Is this your first time back to the kitchen?
Yeah.
Today?
Wow.
Yeah.
We actually just recently went to a luncheon at Castle for the heart patients, open heart surgery. The doctors and the ICU nurses were amazed at his progress, that he was walking without a cane, that he had no cognitive damage, he was not paralyzed, he was speaking, and...
Miracle upon miracle upon miracle.
Yeah.
That blows me away,
yeah.
Hearing your story, and then the fact that this would be the first day that you're back here,
yeah.
The culmination of the places where you were standing in faith when he couldn't,
yeah.
The what you said about the saints coming around you and gathering in prayer, literally being buoyed by the prayers of the saints.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, at the same time, I think, you know, the New Hope Ohana really helps out, you know.
The value of being connected.
Yeah.
I had my woman in the work group praying. I had my
Our small group praying. Came in.
Wow. Our MPL ministry that was all praying for him.
Yeah.
The different people provided meals and support and all kinds of help.
Wow.
We are so grateful for them.
Oh,
yeah.
Goodness. Well, I think what blows me away along with all of this is that we're sitting here and we're not out of the woods yet, you know?
Mm-hmm.
We're still in process, but what makes it so powerful is not only what you're saying about the medical professional saying, how is this possible? And of course, we know how it's possible, right?
Yeah.
It's God. He's on our side. He is
right.
Fighting for
right.
us. But I think what makes this story so powerful, it's the story in the storm. It's not on the other side of the storm. You're still sharing the story and you're still seeing its outcome, still walking
yeah.
it out. Because the world in which we live is in process. They're in pain. They're struggling to believe. They're looking for some kind of a handhold. How do I get through this impossible situation? And your story says, even while it's still playing out, God is real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And even though you've just returned today, your employees know what you're going through. You know,
yeah.
they know what's happening. And then how this story continues to carry out, the power of who God is in our lives isn't most powerfully preached from a pulpit
yeah.
or on a stage. It's in flower-covered floors, you know, it's in hospital rooms. It's where the rubber meets the road, right? Where life really happens. And you guys, by your faith, by you refusing to take any of these things and say, nope, that's my God's gonna do something.
Yeah.
That is speaking volumes
yeah.
beyond what can ever be communicated inside of a church building.
Yeah, I think because of her faith, I mean, he's really stand fast on that faith. I was able to come out of it, you know? Like
wow.
what the Lord said in the Bible, you know, you can have as small as a mustard seed
yeah.
faith, you know, but that's good enough, you
yeah.
know?
Yes.
Well, you guys want to end this time in prayer before we dig into some pizza?
Yeah.
Sure.
All right, let's do that. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for all that you do, the fact that you're working on our behalf
yes.
when we don't even know it, Lord, and just the testimony of this couple right here, of Cesar and Karen, Lord. God, we stand back and we're amazed at what you have done, and we're thankful, God, that you work on our behalf when we cannot. Lord, you bring healing, Lord, where we cannot. Mm. And God, you bring provision where we cannot. And we thank you for what you have done. Thank you, Father, so much for this couple. And we just continue to pray blessing over them, yes, healing over them, Jesus, and provision, yes, over them. Thank you for this pizza as well. We're about to eat. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. I love my job. I love my job. How many are hungry in here? Who's hungry? I thought so. And I'm praying that as much as your stomach is growling right now, God will give you a hunger to share your story with the lost. In fact, can we go ahead and thank, we have Cesar and Karen right here with us. Can we go ahead and thank them? So thankful for you sharing your story in the storm, because it helps us with our stories in the storm, and then that helps others with their stories in the storm. It's like concentric circles of grace that works its way out into our lives because you guys let us stand with you. It's such a privilege to do this with you, and I can't wait to see what God's going to do next. And by the way, if you're really, really hungry right now and you're mad at me for all that pizza I was eating on there, I got good news for you. Right outside, we got our Y Pack, and they're raising money to go to Florida, and they're selling these discount coupons to Z Pizza, and so you can, it's a win-win-win. You can help them, and you can help Y Pack, and you can help your bellies know what to eat after lunch. So just plan on stopping by there. It's right next to Cafe Fusion over there, and pick yourself up some tickets. But here's what I want you to understand is that that your pulpit probably looks very different from mine. I'm going to preach the gospel the best way that I know how, and right now that's from this pulpit here, but your pulpit probably doesn't look like this. What does their pulpit look like? It looks like a pizza place, right? It looks like a pizza counter. It looks like a pizza oven. That's their pulpit, that they're preaching the gospel of Jesus to everybody that they're working with and all the customers that they're interacting with. What's your pulpit look like? Just after the 7 o'clock service last night, I had a man come up to me. He said, I totally was tracking with what Cesar was saying. I tell my guys the same thing on his work crew. It's called Eager Beaver Tree Trimming. And he says, when my guys are going up there in the 60-foot coconut tree and the wind is blowing and they're back and forth and they just want to do a rush job, I said, no. You're trimming that tree for God. That's your ministry. You don't come down until that tree looks the way God wants it to look. And I'm like, that's amazing. So what's this pulpit look like? It doesn't look like this. It looks like tree trimming. I talked to another woman after just this last service, and she was in tears just saying, thank you so much for reminding me this is my ministry. She's a chiropractor. And she says, when I'm talking with people and they start opening up, a lot of times I'm going to hear God begin to speak through me as I pray for them, literally laying hands on them as a chiropractor. What's her pulpit look like? It's a chiropractor bench. It doesn't look like anything like this. Can I just make sure that you know that your pulpit is just as important, if not more so, than the one that I'm preaching from? Because your life, your story, your message, your hope, your grace is going to reach their ears and their lives much sooner than mine will. You're working with them. You're rubbing shoulders with them. You're interacting with them in a way that I never could. Don't discount the power of God's providence that he's preaching through your pulpit right where you work. Right where you're going to wake up and go to tomorrow. In fact, I really think this is what Paul was getting at in Ephesians chapter 2. We're going to kind of be camping out on this verse, these powerful verses. Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 8. If you've got your Life Connect Bible, it's on page 1430. It's also in your notes. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves. It's the gift of God. Not by works. No one can boast about it. We're God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. I want you to go back up top to verse 8 and underline that word grace, because this is the foundation for everything that we're doing. Did you guys feel the grace coming off that story there? Waves and waves of grace
coming off of their story as they shared it in the middle of the waves and waves of fear and turmoil and doubt and struggle. And God brings that grace that brings us through the storm. And it's important that we understand it's by grace that we're saved. Otherwise, we're going to buy into the lie that something else can save us, or even worse, that we can save ourselves. And that will actually destroy the story in the middle of the storm. See, if we're not careful, we buy into the lie that it's not grace that we're saved. We'll put something else in the blank, like, oh, maybe good looks. For some of you, that may work. For me, I'm plumb out of luck. Maybe it's by good living or good loving or a good marriage or good money or a good ministry. I'm going to be saved by my ministry. A good planning, good promotion, good politics. Well, good luck on that. Good hair. Sorry, some of you guys already left out on that one. Good hype, good health. If we learn anything from Caesar's story, it's what? That we are saved by grace. In fact, what was John Bevere preaching last week? That there is no good outside of God. That good without God is simply not enough. If we're preaching any other gospel but the gospel of grace, then somehow we're setting ourselves up as the Savior when there's really only one. Now, why is this important? Because what the world needs to see is what grace looks like. We're seeing an amazing grace. What's that look like lived out in the middle of the storm? Why was their story so powerful? Because they're still in the storm. And yet they're shouting to the grace of God, to the faithfulness of God. They're standing, holding tightly to the mast of God in the middle of the waves. I love that. That's so powerful. So what are you saying, John? That when you follow God, you're going to understand everything? It's all going to make sense? No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm not saying it's all going to make sense. It doesn't make sense to me why an amazing couple like this would have to go through what they went through, apart from the theological reality that we live in a fallen world, a world filled with sin. It doesn't make sense to me why they'd have to go through it. I'm not saying it all makes sense, but I am saying this. Nothing makes sense without Jesus. Nothing makes sense without Him. You don't need to answer everybody's question. You don't need to have an answer for everybody's wonderings and worries and fears. You just need to share your story. Because when you realize that we've been saved by grace, there's no room for stained glass saints. No room for stained glass saints. See, I love this picture. It's so beautiful. This woman walking in her church and the sun shining through the beautiful artistry of the stained glass. But let me ask you, who does stained glass benefit? Only the people that are on the inside. It doesn't benefit anybody on the outside. And what we must remember is the reason why He tells our stories in the storms is because He came for not just those that are in this building or watching online right now. He came for all of those that are still on the outside looking in. We don't need stained glass saints. I don't need you to be perfect. Please don't wait to tell your story until it's all resolved. God's not looking for prepackaged saints. He's looking for the fresh. He's looking for the real. He's looking for those who are willing to hold on to Him even when they're not sure of the outcome, because God is real no matter what. No matter what else happens, my God is real. That's what I heard from them. That's what the world needs to hear from us. Stained glass saints? No, the world doesn't need that. The world doesn't need to just have us live our faith out within the confines of these walls. No, they need to see our story in the middle of the storm. I'm done with limiting God's expression and the goodness of my God to whatever can be seen here on an hour and a half on a service. No, we need to show our story out there. The world is waiting to see your story. Step out from behind the glass. Show them your story in the storm, and they're going to see the Savior that their heart was made to know. That's what we're called to. Work is where people see the story in the storm. Work is also where, point two, we join in with what Jesus was already doing before we got there. Yeah, Jesus was already at work before day one of our getting hired. Think about that. Wherever it is that you work, Jesus was already there. What do you mean? Yeah, He was already working in your employer. He was already working in your fellow employees. God was already at work before you got to work with the customers that you serve and are knowing and seeing on a regular basis. He is at work because His heart is that all would come to know Him. So He's constantly drawing people to Himself, and all He's saying is, will you work with me? God's already there before you got there. If we're not careful, we start living for the weekend instead of living for what God wants to do during the week. We start living for Palhana. when God is wanting to do something inside of the hearts and the lives of the people that we're rubbing shoulders with. We start waiting for that clock to strike the right time so we can get out of there. And God is saying, I want you to see your work as a divine appointment, something that I have set up from the beginning, from beforehand, that you would walk into it. How can I say this? Well, this is the ministry we've been called to. We've been called to the ministry of Jesus, and Jesus describes how it works. John chapter 5, verses 19 through 20. Can you read this with me? Ready? Go. Jesus gave them this answer. Very truly, I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, and he will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. And the world will be amazed when we start working with God. God is going to show you what he's already up to if you're willing to look for it. This is the way Jesus did ministry. He walked into a village. He said, Father, what are you up to here? You're already at work. You show me what we're going to do today. How are we going to spend our time? It may have involved the paralytic sitting at the gate. It may have involved the elderly woman with the sick son. It may have involved a tax collector that everybody hated. He didn't know until he walked in. He saw what the Father was doing, and he jumped into work with what the Father was already preparing beforehand. It's kind of like when I went and visited Cesar and his crew at Z Pizza. I didn't prepare anything. They prepared everything before I even got there. All that fresh ingredients, it takes hours to prep all of that stuff because it's not out of a can. It's all fresh. They had to slice all that stuff up. That oven, 600 degrees. They had to fire that puppy up long before I ever got there. And then my Miyagi, right? He's there and he's teaching me, John, don't be cheating the customer. You got to stretch out that crust, right? He's having patience with me. Why? Because I didn't know how to do that, but he did. He's the expert. I'm not. And he's the one showing me. And this is how God wants us to show up at work, wherever your work is, with the expectation that he's prepared beforehand something you're about to walk into. He's already got that oven fired up. He's already got that heart prepared to the person that you're going to be interacting with that day. Are you coming in with the expectation that just like when they open up their store, customers are going to be ordering and they're ready for it? Are you going to come ready for all God wants to do? Because it goes way beyond your paycheck. It goes into the divine design, the way he has crafted and made you. And he's put you right there in that office, right there in that cubicle. I don't know what your pulpit looks like, but there's a reason he's got you behind it. And just like Caesar had patience with me, our God has patience with us. He wants to show us what he's up to. He wants to invite us into the work with him. As long as we don't get caught up in the thing that will stop our story short, and it's the Savior complex. There's no room for the Savior complex in the story that God wants you to share. How ridiculous would it have been for me to go in and tell Caesar, step aside. I know how to throw the dough. I know how to I know how to put these toppings on here. I know how to put the pizza in the oven. I can light this myself. No, that would have been absolutely arrogant, ridiculous, and it would have ended up in an awful mess. Nothing would have tasted good. Why? Because that's not my kitchen, it's his kitchen. Can I just say, wherever it is that you work, it doesn't belong to you, it belongs to him. I got good news for you. I'm just going to take the pressure off of you right now. You don't need to save anyone. Yep, it's not your job. You just have to serve everyone. You're not supposed to save anyone. There's only one Savior, and you're not him, and neither am I. He does the heavy lifting, just like Caesar did before I even got there. He's preparing everything. He's going to do the saving. He's going to do the delivering. He's going to do the convicting. All you and I have to do is the serving. So let's set aside the Savior complex, and let's get the Savior's heart, which is to what? Come and serve. To give our lives as a ransom for many, just like our Savior did. How do we join in with what the Father's already doing at work? We set our hearts to serve. Is that easy? No. But the worst thing we can do in trying to tell somebody about Jesus is to come off as if we are the one that's going to save them. Because then we keep waiting for our story to be perfect. We keep waiting to have all the answers. And so we never actually show who the Savior is because all they see is us when we want them to see Him. I remember having this Savior complex. I didn't realize I had it. But I graduated from Bible college and, you know, now I was an expert. And I remember my parents pastored a small church in the Santa Ynez Valley in California. And I was gonna show them how church was done, you know? I was gonna tell them. And I was gonna go and I was gonna start a youth group, and I just pictured in my head all the youth coming and just falling on their knees saying, "What must we do to be saved?" Right? I thought, this is God, I'm gonna bring revival to this valley. I'm gonna show them how it's done. Now fast forward 6 months, and I'm 4:30 in the morning inside of a milk box, and my fingers are numb, and I'm stocking whole milk and skim milk and 2% milk and chocolate milk, and I am having it out with God. I'm like, what am I doing here? I went to Bible college for 4 years. Why am I stocking milk? This is not what I signed up for. I don't know if you guys talk to God that way, but I was letting God have it. This is ridiculous. My pulpit is at the church down the street. That's where everything was supposed to happen, and I'm here. Why am I here? Well, first of all, I was there because, well, you have to make a living. And my parents' church was too small. And so I had to get a job. And so I got a job as a grocery backroom manager for a little small independent grocery store called El Rancho Market in Santa Ynez. And there I was scanning in for, I was in charge of the whole back room, so all the bread vendors that would come in, all the chip vendors that would come in, all the soda drink vendors that would come in, they all had to come through me and I had to scan them all in. And I was so angry, because this is not what I signed up for. So therefore, I was a real lousy witness. You see, when you have a Savior complex, you're not working with the Savior. You're actually getting in the way of what the Savior wants to do. And I hate to say it, but it took me like a year, year and a half before I finally woke up to where my pulpit was. And it really wasn't at my church down the street. My pulpit, as it turned out, was in that milk box with the guy stocking milk next to me. My pulpit was right there in the bread aisle as we were facing the bread and bringing it all forward. My pulpit was in the back room as pallets of Pepsi and Coke are being brought in. My pulpit was right there as I was scanning it in. All that Pepperidge Farm fishy crackers, my pulpit was right there. And I didn't realize it for way too long, but when I finally got rid of the Savior complex and I took up the servant's heart, that's when I began to see my real ministry begin to thrive. You see, I took an interest in them instead of asking them to take an interest in me. I began to ask them what was going on in their story. I began to show what was going on in my story, whatever storm I was going through. And you know what? God began to move. I'd find myself scanning in oral wheat. And a guy tells me about his marriage. And I say, "You mind if I pray for you?" And he'd be like, "Hey, I don't go to church." I said, "That's okay. You don't have to go to church because God's right here. Can we pray?" He's like, "Sure." And then I would pray right there. Whoa. Can we do that? Absolutely. Let's just pray. Not religious, just really talking to God about it. And then I would ask him about it the next week. "Hey, remember how we prayed about that? What's going on?" He was like, "You know what? Something happened. Why? That was God. He loves you. He loves your wife." And I just started seeing more and more things opening when I stopped limiting God to the pulpit on the stage and I started seeing the presence of God in the back room of El Rancho Market. And God wants to preach through you that same way. And your message is going to be much better than my message here because I don't know the people you know. I don't work with the people you work with. I don't know their stories like you know their stories. And God has put you there because God is at work and He wants to work through you. You don't have to be the Savior. Take that pressure off. You don't have to save all the people where you work. Let God do that. You just have to serve Him. In fact, it was there at El Rancho that we were there in the morning when the towers got hit on 9/11. And they, of course, all knew that I was a pastor. And where did they need to find God in the middle of all those unanswered questions? Not at church on Sunday. They needed to find it right there in the grocery store on 9/11. And I didn't have answers, but I knew to talk to the one who did. And I got to pray with so many of them on that day. That's why you are where you are. That's why you work where you work. That's why you're called to serve, not save. Serve. I got the opportunity to go back there 14 years later. I got to show my boys the milk box where I'd spent so many cold mornings, the back room where there were still pallets of all kinds of products. I would stand there entering in data. these two ladies right here were the same, some of the same ones that I had worked with all those years before. And before I left that day, they pulled me aside and they reminded me of some things that we had prayed through and talked through. You know what? None of them ever came to my church, but all of them got to see Jesus because Jesus was at work through me. That's your pulpit. Doesn't look like this one. And your pulpit is going to be preached from the way you live your life. All you got to do is join in with what Jesus is already doing. You don't even have to do the heavy lifting. You're just going to walk in with eyes saying, God, what are you up to today? And then you're going to jump in that with them. So work is where the story's in the storm. Work is where we join in with what Jesus is already doing. And finally, work is where we allow God. We discover what to do with what we've been given by God's grace. You see, well, there's no room for boasting. This is a free gift from God. And maybe you're saying, John, I really don't have a lot to offer. I don't have a lot of talents and gifts. And I would just say to you, I understand how that feels because I feel that way a lot. But the fact of the matter is that God doesn't make junk. And he has given you exactly what you need to be able to show who he is to the world around you. It's a discovery process. And I'm hoping that you can see here, even as we're reminded in Ephesians 2:10, we are God's handiwork. God doesn't make junk. Created in Christ Jesus to do mediocre works, average works, passable works. No. What kind of works? Good works. He's created us to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. I'm going to unpack this verse more next week, but let's just understand it here and now that because God has prepared these good works that we're walking into now, he knows exactly why you are where you are. It's not by accident or happenstance. It's not just because you couldn't get any other job. That forever long you are where you're working, God has planned in advance that you would walk in that place. And you would do it with the gifts that God's given you. And what that means is that there's no room for bland, boring, or blank space evangelism. No room for that at all. I mean, when I'm working with Cesar, I mean, you look at his face there, and it's like, that's kind of a mix of, oh, good, I'm glad it's not going to land on my face. I'm glad it's not going to land on a customer. I'm glad it's not landing on the floor. But all it took was that morning working with Cesar and his employees to see that his passion and his gifts worked its way through every other employee in the pizza place. There was nothing boring, bland, or blank about how he was working there because why? It was as unto the Lord. Cesar, Karen, they discovered their gifts and they're seeing God's gift used at the pulpit, which is, for them, it's the pizza place. And I love seeing that discovery process, how it worked its way out. And I left that word evangelism for the very end because I thought, you know what, if I start out with the word evangelism, I might lose a bunch of you. Because most of us don't like the E word. We have a really bad impression of evangelism. Immediately it conjures up strange images of like the wild-eyed, crazy-haired man standing on the corner in the sandwich board and shouting everybody that comes across, the end is near. Right? Or even worse, maybe the guy on TV with the sweat coming off of his forehead and a big old Bible beating everybody over the head and his hair's really, really big and he's yelling at everybody saying, you will go to hell unless you send me money. Right? Or maybe it's somewhere in between, but most of us just don't have a great, great impression of evangelism, let alone do we walk in it. Here's the deal. Not everyone's called to be an evangelist, but every believer is called to evangelism. Why? Well, evangelism is mentioned 52 times in the New Testament. The original Greek, euangelion, means good news. Now, if we just get rid of that word evangelism and I'd say, hey, it's your responsibility when you go out today to share some good news, all of us are signing up. Who doesn't want to share some good news? In fact, we live in a world surrounded by people that can't find good news anywhere. You're certainly not going to find it in the news. You're not going to find it in the current political realm. You're usually not going to find it at home. You're not going to find it at work. Where are you going to find it? You're going to find it with the people who've already found it. And by the way, that's you. And you up there, and you watching online right now, you found the good news. It's simply your responsibility to what? Share it. To let people know about it. Well, how do I do that? With the amazing gifts, talents, and abilities that God has given you. Now, let me give you an example of what good evangelism looks like and bad evangelism looks like. Let me show you real quick here.
Oh, yeah. What? What are you guys looking at? Let me show you bad evangelism. Oh, God, the worship today was amazing. Ooh, oh, God, the pastor's message was fire. Oh, that was so good. I learned so much. I took so many good notes. I had some good time at church today. Thank you, Jesus. You're so good. Yeah. What? What you want? It's mine. Think I'm going to share this with you. We're supposed to, but a lot of times we don't. This is bad evangelism. The world looking on, wondering what this whole Jesus thing is about, and we're keeping it all to ourselves. Let me show you what good evangelism looks like. Oh, yeah. That's what good evangelism looks like. People stand in line for it. It's cut in slices. It's made to be shared, and it's covered with toppings of your gifts, your talents, and your abilities, the way God has designed you, by His grace, giving you everything you need for the people around you. And they're hungry for this, not this. This, not this. Right? And if we're not careful, all the world's going to see is a cardboard box. You know what this cardboard box is? It's religion. Here, you chew on this. You chew on. How's that? No, that's disgusting. What they want is what's inside the box. If we keep whatever it is that God's bringing here, if we keep it inside of here, the world is never going to know how good He is. I'm telling you this morning, He's serving up hot. He's serving it up fresh. He's serving it straight to you. But if we keep it in here, the world's never going to know how good our God is. So I'm asking you this morning, who's ready to be a delivery person? Because I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to bring it to the world out there because this is what they want. This is what they're hungry for. This is what they need to see. Not that something prepackaged. I'm not going to throw some kind of frozen DiGiorno at them. No, God has given it to you hot and fresh. So that you can bring it to them hot and fresh. So who's going to be a delivery girl in this room? Got a couple? Who's going to be a delivery boy in this room? 30 minutes or less, people. Because the world, they need to know how good our God is. Taste and see. He is good. Well, He's real good. You see, bad evangelism, you've got to talk people into just giving you a minute. Good evangelism, people are standing in line to hear more of your story. Because it's real. It's fresh. It's organic. It's right where they're at. It makes sense. It's not religious. It's not cardboard. It's not prepackaged. And you're not selfishly keeping it to yourself. We would understand that everything God gives us is to be given away. Guess what happens? We open it up and He fills it up with more. Nothing frozen, nothing processed, fresh, straight out of the oven. God's firing up the oven today. Can you feel it? God wants to stir inside of His people a hunger for the lost. That there are so many people out there that don't know this is actually what it looks like to belong to Jesus. Not this, but this. And how is He going to know that? Except from your pulpit. Except from your delivery. And the address that God calls you to. Now don't mob Lanu. She's a nice lady. Don't jump at her. Look, she's teasing you guys. She's teasing you. Because how are we going to do that, John? Well, I want you guys to get your notes. And I want you to look at I'm going to give you some homework for work. And I'm going to challenge you to something called the 21-day push. Okay? The 21-day push between now or tomorrow and Sunday is 21 days, Easter Sunday. And I'm going to call us to a focus. Daniel focused for 21 days to pray for a breakthrough. I'm going to call us to do the same. Let me clarify here. Push is not push people into the kingdom. Please don't. I don't know if you've ever tried that. But when you try and push people towards God, it usually what? Pushes them away from God. No, we're not pushing anybody. We're going to let God draw people to Himself. Well, we're going to push ourselves in prayer because push means pray until something happens. Repeat that with me. Pray until something happens. Now, maybe you don't know how to pray. We'll start here. Daniel 9, 1 through 19. If you don't know how to pray, one of the best ways to learn how to pray is to pray the prayers in Scripture. You start praying that prayer. Start praying that over your coworkers. Then the second point is I want you to fill in five names of people that you want to see come to know Christ. Can I just encourage you, as you're considering who to pray for the next 21 days, don't just write in your buddies and your pals. It could be that you're supposed to write in that person that gets on your last nerve every time you show up to work. Right? You try and avoid them when you're getting your coffee. Right? You don't really talk to them. It could be that's the very person God wants you to write in there because Jesus died for them too. I know as hard as it is to feel any good feelings towards them, something will happen in your heart towards that person. If you bring that person to the Lord for the next 21 days, God will begin to show you how he sees them. And who knows? But God has done crazier things than leading people that are far from him towards him. And God knows he has taken obnoxious people and made them saints. Can I hear an amen? Because there's a bunch of us in here. There's a bunch of us in here. I'm so glad that someone prayed for me. I'm so glad that someone didn't give up on me. I'll write those names in there. Then I want you to read through your new creation bookmark, something Pastor Wayne put together. You all have one in your bulletin. It answers some questions with Bible verses. What has Jesus done? What can I become in him? What must I do to be saved? And where do I start? Now, if you don't know Jesus, I want to invite you to join us out at the Yes Tent out there. And we'd love to introduce you to your Lord and Savior. If you do know Jesus, I want you to read this over. Even if you've been a Christian for a long time, I want you to pray through these verses for the next 21-day push. Why? Because something amazing happens. You hide God's word in your heart, and then he takes out that word right when we need it. It's usually going to be over a coffee break, maybe lunch hour. Maybe there's going to be a lull and the customer's coming in and you guys just start talking story with your fellow employees. And what's going to come out in your conversation is whatever you've hidden in your heart. He's going to bring to your remembrance exactly what you need to say when you need to say it. And you know what? Something cool is going to happen. You pray through these scriptures for the next 21 days. You're going to find you've memorized them and that they begin to work their way out in conversations with those that you work with. And finally, because we just want to equip you as much as possible, we want to conquer as many fears as possible. And we're not all called to be evangelists, but we're all called to evangelism, to share God's good news. We have Gary Goslin, who runs our Yes Ministry, where those Yes packets that we try and get into your hands to help you with your next steps when you ask Christ into your heart. He also runs our MPL Ministry, our Marketplace Leadership. And he's got some real practical tools to help you lead people to the Lord, or at least start a conversation about God in ways that work in the 21st century. And if you're interested about that, we've got a free class. It's only 20 minutes. It's right under the Yes Tent, right out there. We're going to give you some tools right before you leave today. If you just stop by that tent, Gary's got some good stuff for you. But all of this is about asking you to decide, not with fanfare, not any hype, but asking you to decide and answer with me right now. Are you ready to take the 21-day push? To pray from Monday to Easter Sunday that God would do something beyond what we could do? If you are, would you show by standing right now? Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Look what you're doing in your church, God. We're going to take what you've given us in here, and we're not leaving it in here. Oh, God, it's what we're hungry for, to be used by you. God, right now, we just thank you, God, what you're stirring in our hearts to believe for the impossible. We want to thank you in advance for these five people that we're going to be praying for the next 21 days. We want to thank you, God, that you died for them, and they're going to come to know you. God, we want to thank you, God, for where it is that we work. Sometimes we like to be there, sometimes we don't, but we know now that you're there. And we want to join in with what you're doing. We want to say yes, God, to the works that you prepared beforehand, that we would walk into them. There's a world hungry for what it is that you've already given us. And we're not going to keep it to ourselves anymore. We're not handing them religion, something prepackaged or cardboard. No, we're handing them something fresh, something real, something true. Simply by showing you to the people that we work with and work for. We believe, God, that you are stirring your people to have a hunger for the lost. We believe that every person that we know, you died for, and we want them to come to know you. Would you use us to do that, Lord? Would you use us to do that? We give these next 21 days to you. We're going to see what you're doing and jump in with it. In your mighty name, Jesus, we pray and we thank you. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God.